I just wanted to give you just kind of a little bit of my testimony about how I got saved. I grew up in a good Bible-believing church and family. My dad here and my mom brought me up the right way under the admonition of the Lord. I didn't get saved until I was 23 years old, though. I was 25 years old until I got saved. One verse, my favorite verse, is Proverbs 22:6, which says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." And I remember one day when I was working, just to let you know, I grew up through middle school, high school, college, thinking here and there about where I was going to go, but not very often. Because, you know, you think about just the pace of this world, it gets you to the point where you just don't even care, for the most part, about thinking about where you're going to go in eternity. When I talk to people on the streets, when I talk to people wherever I'm at, and I say, "Listen, here's a gospel track. Have you ever thought about where you're going to go when you die?" And most of the time people say, "Not really." You know, that would probably be about 99% of the people that you can talk to. They really don't think about where they're going to go, because they're really thinking about the here and now. They're thinking about what's going to happen tomorrow, what's going to happen today, or what's going to happen in their future. They're looking towards the future, but they're not looking towards eternity. And the problem with that is they don't know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Right. And so I remember going through middle school, high school, college, you know, having a little bit of information about the Lord and things like that. But if you would have asked me, I would have told you I was a Christian. Most people today, that's why I don't ask people if they're a Christian. Because right. I go up to them and I say, "Listen, do you know if you're a Christian?" And they'll say, "Oh yeah, I'm a Christian. I was raised a Christian. I was born a Christian. I was baptized." Yeah. They'll say all that kind of stuff. And so when I go up to them, I say, "Hey, listen, do you know for sure you're going to heaven?" And if they say, "Well, I believe I am," this is the thing that I always use. I don't use it all the time, but most of the time I do. I say, "Listen, when you stand before God and he says, 'Why should I let into these pearly gates?' what would you say?" And that divides the line right there between whether or not they're believing in their works or they're believing in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Yeah. And that's where I was at. And I remember when I was just got out of college and I got a great job. I went through x-ray school, so I'm an x-ray technician by trade. I look at bones all day long, and so I don't have x-ray vision, but you can see a lot of bones and things like that. And just to give you a thing too, if you go in and you get x-rays, please do not ask the x-ray tech, "What does it look like?" or "How does it look? Is it broken?" Because almost everybody asks that question. We're by law, by New York State and all that kind of stuff with HIPAA and everything, you can't say a thing. Because I could lose my x-ray license if I say, "Well, it looks pretty good." And then they go see the doctor and they say, "Boy, you got a massive break in your bone." And if they go to the state and they say, "Listen, the x-ray tech told me that it was fine, I'm okay." I could lose my job, and any other x-ray tech could lose their license and never be able to do it again. So just a little information for you if you ever do get x-rays. I always say, "Well, it looks good. We got beautiful pictures. The doctor will let you know." And everybody always gets mad and all that kind of stuff. That's all I can do. I'm sorry. So I went through x-ray school, and then I got out, and I thought I had everything that would make me happy and joyful for the rest of my life. I had a great job where I was making great money. I was only 21 years old when I graduated. Had a great job. I went to school for 2 years. Of course, a great family. I got out, and I had a great apartment. I had a great car. I had just everything that you would think that would make you so happy. Great health. There was nothing wrong with me. You know, young 21-year-old. That was many years ago. But there was just no happiness. And so what started to take place is I started to get involved with alcohol, and then a little bit also in the drugs. And I remember just every day I would come home from work, and that's what I would do. And I'd have this emptiness inside of me, and everybody would be like, "Boy, he's so happy," and everything like that. But then I'd get home, and I'd be miserable. And I remember just using all that stuff just to try and get numb. And there was one store that I used to, there's two stores I love to go into. One is Best Buy. I don't like it as much anymore, and the other is Barnes & Nobles. I love going into a Barnes & Nobles. Any bookstore is good, but I love Barnes & Nobles. You go in there, you have the nice music, you know, the soothing music and all that. You go in there, it just feels good. And as a lost man, I just liked classical music. My dad used to listen to classical music all the time, and when I was growing up, and there's just something about some good classical music that's just good to the soul. And I remember going in there and just like every time before, just going over looking at the computer gaming magazines and things, and going over there and looking at different science fiction magazines and fantasy books and all that kind of stuff. And then I remember for some reason I was led over to the religious section. And if you've ever been over to the religious section, there's a lot of junk there. A lot that you got to wade through. And I remember going through all this stuff, but I remember one thing my dad told me, and one thing that the church that I was at told me, was that you got to pick up a good King James Bible. And you say, how do you remember that? I have no idea. I believe the Lord brought it back to me. I believe the Lord led me over to the religious section. And I remember taking the King James Bible, and I was like, I think this is the right one. I believe this is the one. So I took it, and you know how the Barnes & Nobles usually has just a little tiny area where you can go over and you can have some coffee and, you know, just, you know, cake or whatever you want. You have a little section there where you can sit down with whatever you want to read. So I remember taking the Bible over there, and I remember opening up to Genesis 1:1. And I remember reading, in the beginning was the word, was in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. And I said, boy, that's the word of God. I remember reading down through the book of Genesis, and I remember reading over, because I always, you know, heard you got to go to the book of John. So I remember going to the book of John. And then I just started reading probably the first five chapters, I believe it was, of the book of John. And I started reading through there, and I said, there's no doubt about this. This is what I need. Just that this, the words of God just witnessed to my heart and my soul, this is what was missing in my life. I mean, I had everything that you would ever think that would make you happy, would make you joyful. And there was times when I was happy, of course. But there was times there was just something that was inside, like a little hole in me that I could feel that was missing. And so when I read this word of God, it's just like it started to fill up, it felt like, almost. And I remember buying that Bible. I remember going home, and I remember reading it that night. It was a Friday night. I remember Saturday morning, I woke up, and I just started reading the Bible again. And I remember I was in an apartment in Mount Vernon, New York, right outside the Bronx. I remember right on the kitchen dining room table there, I remember knowing I was a sinner. I remember knowing that because of my sins, I knew I deserved hell. And I knew that if I was to die right then and there, I would go to hell for all of eternity. And I was scared. And I remember knowing that Jesus Christ could save me because of what he did on that cross. How he died for my sins. He was buried and he rose again the third day. And that if I call upon him, repent of my sins and call upon him, he would save me. And man, that day, that morning, I remember tears in my eyes. I just bowed my head and I said, Lord, please save my soul from hell. I accept you as my Savior. And boy, I don't know, you know, I'm not a big guy about feelings and things like that. I'm not a big feely guy. But man, that day, there was this a weight lifted off my shoulders. And I just remember, man, I know where I'm going when I die. And I remember having that Bible that I had from Barnes & Noble underneath my shoulder like this. And I remember just walking around, just the, I was subletting this apartment from this this gentleman, from this lady that I worked with and her husband. And I remember him and I used to hang out all the time. And boy, I was just so excited. I wanted to tell somebody. So I remember going over to him. I remember knocking on his door, and I remember him opening up the door, you know, the smoke of pot and everything like that was just permeating out. And I remember his eyes were all glazed over, and I was like, I can't just, in words, I can't explain to you what I just did. And he's like, oh yeah, what do you do? And I said, I just accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. And you should have saw the look on his face. He was like, what? He couldn't believe it. And I was so excited. I said, man, I knew I was a sinner. I knew I was on my way to hell. I accepted him as my Savior. Isn't that amazing? And he wasn't so happy. Here is this guy that for a couple years of living there, about a year and a half, I believe it was, of living there, he was almost a real close friend to me. And I remember right when I did that, I could see just the countenance of his face change. And I remember saying to him, hey, listen, have you ever read this book? Isn't it amazing? And he's like, oh, yeah, I've read it a couple times through. I said, well, man, what's your best part? And he's like, ah, you know, I've read the Quran, I've read all that kind of stuff. And I said, well, man, how can you read through it? So I knew right then and there he didn't read the Bible. Right. He just wanted to say that he wanted me to, you know, leave and so he could shut the door and things like that. But man, I remember having this Bible, and I remember that this had all the answers to it. Amen. All the answers that you'd ever want to ask that you have in this lifetime. And I remember just some of the things that I learned when I was a kid at Good Bible Believing Church in Lockport there under Pastor Scott Strobel. And I remember going, and I remember telling people, I remember at the, because it's not the best community that I lived in. It was Mount Vernon, New York. I don't know if you know where that is, but it's right outside the Bronx. And so you had a gated community. So you'd have to go through the gate. And there was a gentleman there. I remember just, I can't remember his name, but a nice black gentleman that I remember we used to hang out a lot as well. And I remember going up to him, and I remember just saying, man, I got saved the other day. And he was actually pretty accepted of it, you know, but he wasn't saved. But he had a big drinking problem. And I said, man, I don't want alcohol ever again. And I don't, you know, I know the Bible says that you're not supposed to drink alcohol. You're not even supposed to look at it. And he said, well, where is that in the Bible? And I said, I don't know. I said, I know it's in there, but I can't tell you exactly where it is. And you know what? That started to bother me. That started to bother me when I couldn't tell somebody where things were in the Bible. I remember going to other people I remember when I moved finally into the Bronx and I was starting to go to a good Bible-believing Baptist church there in the Bronx, a storefront church. I remember going door knocking there, and most of the people there speak Spanish, and I cannot speak Spanish. So I'd be like, Jesus, 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 you know, and I try and we have some Spanish gospel tracks. I didn't know what else to say, you know, because they didn't understand me. But I remember I finally got a gentleman that could speak English. I was so excited. And I just remember that day, if you've ever gone door knocking, a lot of times they try and talk about anything else but the gospel. And I remember I was on medication for acne, and man, that stuff just totally chaps your lips and your skin. And it was such a strong medication that you had to get blood work, right? Because they were afraid of your liver and everything shutting down. So I remember having my lips so chapped, and I looked like I was, you know, in the desert for about 2 weeks without water. And so here I am, and I got this opportunity to be able to talk to this guy, and the first thing he said, man, what is wrong with your lips? He's like, use some chapstick, you know? So, man, I was so nervous to begin with. Then he says that to me, and I'm like, oh, man, okay, composure, get myself composed. And I said, no, that doesn't matter right now. What matters is your soul, where you're going to go when you die. And I remember him saying, well, how do you know that word is the word of God? How do you know that Bible is from God? And I remember him saying to him, well, number one, it's the prophecy of Jesus Christ. I said, you know that this is the word of God because no other religious writing on this earth has any prophecy in it. And he said, well, show me some. And I couldn't show him any. And he said, and I said to him, well, not only prophecy, but the Bible even says that the world is round. It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth. He said, well, where is that? I said, I don't know where that is. Wow. And you know what? After just a few times of people saying to me, where is that in your Bible? It really got me to thinking, I got to study my Bible. And I remember my dad, he's going through a lot of correspondence courses that you get the tapes and everything like that. It's an institute, a college institute for good Bible-believing teaching that he had. So I got some of that from him, and I started studying, and I just loved it. Fell in love with the Word of God. I was like, listen, I want to know the best I can to be able to answer people. Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason the hope is in you with meekness and fear. And that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be able to have an answer for everybody. And I remember when I got saved, I remember finally starting to learn some things in this book and be able to answer some of the questions. And really, if you've ever gone witnessing a lot, you know there's about maybe 100 questions at most that just keeps reoccurring. Yeah. And there's probably about 10 questions that almost everybody asks. Mm. You know, what about the people that have never heard? You know, what about babies? What about all this? And you just go over the same questions and you're able to get that answer, finally have it written down even in your Bible. Anything that you can do. I've got a bad memory, just to let you know. I write things down in my Bible, tape it wherever I can so that I'd be able to go to it. And if I can give any kind of admonition today, that would be one of the things is when you're witnessing, have it just up here and be able to just say your testimony, but also be able to use the verses. Because the Bible says in Romans 10:17, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. This word of God is the thing that's quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. This is the thing that's going to work on them. So it worked on me. I got saved. And I remember, man, I just wanted to go to a Bible institute. I wanted to actually go physically. The Lord never led me. So I did correspondence courses through Charity Baptist Bible Institute out in Dayton, Ohio. And man, that gave me a solid foundation. And I was able to, I'm still at my church right now in Martville. Still serving the Lord there and still trying to win some souls. And but you say, how in the world did you get called to the Arctic? Well, that's a story in of itself. You know, I've been going, I was living in Syracuse for about 6 years. And the Lord, of course, led me out to the church in Martville out there. So I was traveling about 50 minutes each way to go to church. And man, when you go 50 minutes to church each way, you kind of get tired of traveling that distance. Hey man, I needed something just to kind of kill the time. So I started putting sermons, preachers, on my CD and putting it in my CD player. And I was able to fit 2 sermons this one day on this CD. So I just kind of at random, on a Wednesday night I believe it was, I put 2 sermons on random, just from my library that I have, onto the CD. I didn't know what they were of, I didn't know the pastor or anything like that. I remember going down to Marvel, about 45 minutes from Syracuse, and it was Pastor Brian Donovan. I love his preaching. And I remember him talking about missions. And I've always loved missions. I've always had a heart. Every time somebody comes in and they show their slide presentation and they show the faces of the people that are out there that have gotten saved, the people that are not saved, people that are hurting that need Jesus Christ, and man, it would always just tear at my heart. But I was like, no, Lord will never call me in the missions, you know. And I remember driving down, and I remember him saying one thing that really got me. He said, you know, at a church this size, out of this many people in this church, I believe at least one or two of you have been called, and you just haven't answered the call. I believe you're probably too fat, too lazy, too comfortable to go. And I said, yeah, you get them. Yeah, that's right, you get them. That's probably exactly what their problem is. And but the Lord just started talking to me that way, and he said, okay, just tugging at my heart a little bit about missions, not just giving financially and praying, but actually going. And I remember coming home that night, putting in the second, skipping to the second sermon, and it was on, guess what? It was on missions. And over it was on missions. And hey, listen, you need to go. And he said the same thing. He said, I believe that most likely there's somebody here that has been called, but you're too comfortable to go.
Yeah.
And man, I tell you what, as being an X-ray tech for 10 years, knowing where I'm going to get that that paycheck from, knowing that I'm going to be able to provide for my family the rest of my life, because let me just tell you this, people break their bones all the time. That's not going to stop. Unless we get some kind of Wolverine kind of adamantium in you or something like that. Well, listen, you're going to keep breaking your bones nonstop. So I was like, hell, I was like, well, yeah, maybe that's me. Maybe I'm a little bit too comfortable. Maybe the Lord has told me to go and I just don't want to go. Maybe I've kind of shut my ears a little bit and I didn't want to go. And I remember just the Lord dealing with me. And then right after he had said that, the CD player stopped. And this was about 15 minutes into the... Now, I'm not about signs, all right? I know the signs were given to the Jews. The Jews require a sign. And the Greeks seek after wisdom. I know all that. But man, it stopped. And all of a sudden, the Lord's like, yeah, what about that? And I was like trying to fast forward. I was trying to rewind as fast as I could. And it wasn't working. So I skipped past the next message again, back to the first one. It worked fine. And then I skipped again to the next one. Fast forward all the way up to that point, and then I kept on going through fine.
Yeah.
And man, I was hurting that night. I was like, man, I don't know. And the next day, I remember going to work. And it was one of the little offices. We have 8 different offices in the Syracuse region that I work for. And I was at one of the smaller offices, so I was the only X-ray tech there at the time. Just sitting there, was real slow at that point. And this gentleman came over, and he sat down in the X-ray waiting room that I have right there. And he just started working there about a month ago. I didn't really talk to him very much at all because we both have usually been real busy. And he sat down and he said, well, hey, listen, tell me what you like to do. Tell me what what you love to do when you get out of work and things like that. And on your free time, what do you like to do? And I had my Bible open as I was reading it because it was slow. And I said, well, listen, I got saved a few years ago. And man, I love this book. And I love the Lord Jesus Christ that saved my soul. And when you say that at work, it's kind of nerve-wracking. Because you don't know what's going to happen. Because you don't know if, of course, you're going to get in trouble and things like that. So I always pray about it. I always try and get wisdom from the Lord, what I'm supposed to do. But I just told him flat out. I said, listen, I'm saved, and I love reading this book. And he said, really? He said, well, listen, brother, I've been saved since 79. I said, really? It was so neat. It was so neat just to have that connection. And I said, listen, I got to tell you something, brother. I haven't told anybody else. I haven't told my fiance, Jennifer. She was my fiance at the time. I haven't told her yet. I think the Lord might be dealing with me on missions. And wouldn't you know what he said? He said almost verbatim what those two messages said. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, brother, I believe that's probably a lot of people have been called but are just too comfortable to go.
Wow.
And man, he was saying a whole bunch of stuff after that, and I couldn't tell you what he was saying after that. I mean, all I could think of is exactly what he said and exactly what those sermons said, and the Lord's just dealing with my heart. I remember calling up Jennifer that night. I remember saying to her, listen, I don't know, but I think the Lord might be dealing with me on going on the mission field. I said, not just praying for them, not just financially supporting them, but actually going physically. And I remember saying to her, I said, you know, if you don't want to marry me, I would understand. Because I know that the mission field is not a missionary wife is not the easiest thing to do. And she said, no, it's not. And my wife, her dad has been a Bible-believing Baptist preacher for a long time now. She knows the ministry, the different problems that come with it and things like that, the struggles that go with it, also the blessings that go with it as well, but there's struggles with it. And so I said to her, I said, listen, if you don't want to marry me, I'd understand. I really would, if that's where God calls me. And she said, no, you know what? I believe that the Lord has put us together, and if he's brought us together, then if you're called, then I'm called to go as well. And that meant a lot to me. I mean, that right there, that was like, okay, this is the right girl. And but she made a statement that I believe the whole reason why we're going to the Arctic is because of her. I blame her. But she said this statement. She said, as long as we're not called to the Arctic. I said, oh, come on. We're not going to be called to the Arctic. You know, why would, what is out there? There's nothing out there. Why would God call us there? He'll call us to Africa or someplace like that, you know? So I remember that weekend, I hadn't been to my dad's. He lived in Binghamton at the time. And that weekend, I was already going to go there. I hadn't been there in 2 months now to see him. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to go see my dad. And he said, yeah, come on over, you know? And I love my dad. My dad's my best friend. He's been my best friend for so long, especially now that I gotten saved. Listen, when you get saved and your dad is saved, there's just something about that where it just made that relationship that I had strong with him. Amen. And he's my best man in my wedding, and I just love him.
Praise the Lord.
I remember getting ready to go. It was probably about, it was a Friday now. I was going to leave, it was either Friday night or Saturday night. I remember getting a call from Pastor Matt Smith. He's got a good Bible-believing work out there in Vestal, New York, in Binghamton. And I remember him calling me up, and he said, listen, do you mind taking a missionary? And I knew him very well from Buckley Road Baptist Church in Syracuse. He would go there when he wouldn't have meetings on deputation, so we got pretty close as well. His name's Angelo Serino. And he's like, would you mind taking him and his wife back to us, to Binghamton, you know, just to bring them because they don't have a car? And I said, yeah, no problem at all. You know, I'm going to Binghamton as it is now, so it's no big deal. So I remember getting into the car, getting them in the car, also going to pick them up, and then starting to go on a Saturday morning. And I remember just talking to him. I remember just saying, listen, I got to tell you about this. Just the past few days, Lord's really been dealing with me about going to the mission field. And listen, I don't know. I just hope that you'll pray, you know. And his wife, Shayla, was there. I said, will you pray for me as well? He said, you know what, brother? He's like, he's really been dealing with you the last 3 days on missions? I said, yeah. He said, my wife and I, Shayla, have been praying for you by name the last few days to go and help my dad out in the Arctic. I said, are you serious? I said, well, listen, I'm not going to be called by a man. I'm not going to go out there and be called by a man. And so I just prayed about it and prayed about it. And that next weekend, Pastor Brian Donovan was going to the church in Elbridge. And I usually like to go out there in January. And I remember going there in January when they had their winter revival, I believe it was, that they usually have there. And I remember going there, and I remember I was really struggling because there were some people telling me, you know what, maybe you're just being called by a man, and people are saying different things to me, even people that I knew pretty well. And I know they meant the best and things like that, and I even had my doubts here and there. And I remember one pastor getting up before he preached that first night, and he said, there's a gentleman that came up to me today, a young gentleman that believes he's been called to preach, but people have been telling him that they don't believe that's his calling. Mm. And he said, I just want you to know right now, if you've been called by God to go somewhere, it doesn't matter what anybody else says, you go.
That's right.
Yes. And man, that hit me. And then I was dealing also, I love the street preach. I'll just let you know that right now. I like door knocking. I know we need to do it, and I do it. But that's not the thing that I like to do. I like to street preach. I like to get out there and just deal with people as they go by and try and witness to them and things like that. And I said, Lord, you know, we go out to the Syracuse, to the Dome, to the games, to the SU games, the basketball games, football games, different events. We preach out there to thousands of people. Why do you want me to go out to just a small little land like that where there's, you know, little villages where there's not a whole lot, you know, there's not really any street preaching out there and stuff like that? Why would you want me to go out to a small place like that? And I was really starting to deal with that next night. And I remember these girls got up there. It was either three or four of them. And I remember they getting up there and they sang this one song. It says, in verse 2, this is little as much when God is in it. It says, does the place you're called to labor seem so small and little known? It is great if God is in it and he'll not forget his own. Mm-hmm. And that was the Lord telling me that's where I want you to go. Mm-hmm. He said, you know what? It doesn't matter how small it is. Doesn't matter how big it is. It's not up to you. It's not up to you how many you get saved. It's up to me. And amen. I've called you out there.
Amen.
I said, all right, Lord, I'll go. And you'll see on the video here shortly. I'll get it started here. But when we went out there on our survey trip, I believe that you should read your Bible every single day. Mm-hmm. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4 says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. And listen, we eat 3, 4, 5 meals a day sometimes. And if we're not eating one meal, at least of the Word of God a day, you're malnourished spiritually. And so I was reading my Bible every day, and I remember when I got out there, everything that I was reading every single day lined up exactly along with what we were talking about, with what was being preached, things like that. And that was just, that just sealed the deal for me. And I'm not going, it's a long story about something that the one of the nights that I was there that I read that day, and it just totally lined up with my Bible reading. And I said, all right, there's no doubt about it now. I'm not called by a man, I'm called by God. Amen. And I know I'm supposed to be out here. So I'm going to get this started here. Hopefully this thing is still on. Sometimes it takes a little bit of time. I can talk a little bit more while it's loading up here. But I just want to say, if anybody believes that they might be called by God to go somewhere, maybe you've been called by God to just do more for the Lord, don't be scared like I was. And I mean, of course, I'm still nervous and all that kind of stuff. I still got some fears and things, but I know that the Lord will help me out. Let me just sign in here. This is just a short 5-minute video that I have. And I'll kind of explain. Well, we went on a survey trip. This is the actual pictures and videos and things like that. This picture right here, sorry, they got all these things in the way. But that is the old village that they used to live in. So in the 50s and 60s, they used to live in these sod houses. So what that is there's just a couple pieces of wood there, but most of that is whalebone. You see right there to the left of us? Those are huge whale bones. And what they would do is they would dig underneath the ground a little bit, and they would put those up as a frame, those bones up on the top and inside. We've got pictures inside as well. But what they would do is they'd sod that every year, and they'd live in that all year round.
Wow.
And some of the men, some of the Eskimos that are out there, especially Stephen, he remembers, he loves talking about it. He's so proud about being an Eskimo. He said, when I'm taking a picture of him, he's like, now you're going to be able to go back to New York and tell everybody that you saw a real live Eskimo. He was so happy about it. And he remembers living in these things in the 60s. He remembers getting up in the morning and having to break the ice to get some water. And just unbelievable how they used to live. Now the government has come in. They moved that village. You can still go out there like we just did. You can go out there. You got to be real careful because the wildlife, the polar bears is the biggest problem. You got to go out there with a gun that could actually take them down. But the polar bears, the whole time you're out there, you got to look 360 the whole time you're out there, because those polar bears will come up at you and they'll kill you just with one swipe.
Wow.
So you got to be real careful. But we went out there, and they've got it's like a graveyard of just these old little houses here that they used to have. It's pretty neat. But that's on the other side of the landing strip. Then you go on the other side of the landing strip, then you've got about a mile from there, you've got the new village that the government has come in, and they've made some living quarters for them and things like that. The reason why they had to move is because the water was actually coming up close to their living quarters, so they had to move that. But here, let me start this video, and I'll explain a little bit more here.
Hi, we are Matthew and Jennifer Sutton. We live in Syracuse, New York, and have been attending Emmanuel Baptist.
Oh, sorry about that. That was a video.
Church in Marple, New York, where we have been actively involved in ministry for over 2 years, including being youth leaders for 1 year. We are very thankful for our home church and pastors who have supported and prayed about our call to Alaska. I received my call to go to Point Hope, Alaska in January of 2011. At the time, Jennifer and I had been engaged for a couple months. My heart had always been in missions, but I always assumed that the Lord's will for me was to stay and minister in New York State. After 2 weeks of the Lord dealing with me on being a missionary rather than just supporting missions financially, I surrendered to His will, and a week later the Lord made it clear that we were called to the Arctic. We left for our first survey trip on November 30th of 2012. Our trip started in Newark, New Jersey, and we went through Seattle, then to Kotzebue, and finally ending the next morning in Point Hope, Alaska. As you get off the Bush Pilot plane in Point Hope, Alaska, you're greeted by this airport, a mere landing strip where if the plane goes too far, it will go right into the Arctic Ocean. Point Hope is as far northwest in Alaska as you can go. It is located in North Slope above the Arctic Circle. The village is situated about a mile from the Arctic Ocean, making it ideal for whale hunting, something the natives have done for hundreds of years to survive and still actively do to this day, still using the old-fashioned tools that their ancestors used, such as canoes and harpoons. And this right here is where they have their annual whaling feast. The entire village comes together to celebrate the whaling season and enjoy eating muktuk, which is whale skin and blubber, which is a cultural delicacy. There are over 800 people living in Point Hope, and many live in broken down houses, which are continually damaged by high winds and snow drifts. Though many live in poor conditions, it's common to see a one-bedroom shack with a large satellite dish on it. Much like the lower 48, many put conveniences such as television and internet before the needs of their families. Episcopal, and although they are very religious people and have all the right terminology, most do not truly know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. They're like so many other people who believe that they'll be good enough to get to heaven on their own. This is Tikiup Bible Baptist Church, the only Bible-believing, gospel-preaching church in the village. We will be working with veteran missionaries Nick and Darianne Serino, who have been working in the North Slope for almost 30 years and started the church in Point Hope in 1997. It is a blessing to see the natives coming out to worship the Lord despite the hardships that they face every day, yet there are still so many to be reached, not only in Point Hope, but also in other villages in the North Slope that do not have a Bible-believing church. The natives as a whole love to sing, and once saved, they love to sing and glorify their Savior. Ministries of the church have been growing steadily, and although we are going to help out with all aspects of the ministry, the youth group will be our primary focus. Many of these kids grow up in a household environment of substance abuse and neglect, which breeds a similar pattern in their own lives, causing them to turn to drugs and alcohol at a very young age. Even in the short time that we were there, we were amazed at how starved for affection they were and how they responded to someone being willing to take time with them. This presents us with a great opportunity to fill that need and also minister to their spiritual need for a Savior. Acts 16:31 says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house." Several of these teens are already praying for their parents' salvation. By reaching the youth with the gospel, we can see the younger generation reach the older generation for Jesus Christ. Our mission goals are to train under veteran missionaries, to assist in the ministry of Tikiup Bible Baptist Church, to train future generations through the youth ministry, and to establish Bible-believing churches in the unreached villages of the North Slope. We covet your prayers for the mission work in Point Hope, Alaska. Please pray with us for souls to be saved, lives to be changed, and most importantly, for the Lord Jesus Christ to get all the glory.
Like I said, Brother Serino has been out there for 30 years. So he's already got four churches there in the North Slope and four villages established. But there's still four villages in the North Slope that don't have a Bible-believing, gospel-preaching church. So when you think about it, I mean, here, if you live about an hour, 40 minutes away, you can drive out here to come to church, to a good Bible-believing church. But they can't. They'd have to take a bush pilot plane. The only way that you're accessible to get to any of these villages is by a bush pilot plane. So they're not able to just take a four-wheeler or anything like that and just drive out to one of these places. So that's our burden. We are, Lord willing, going to go out there full-time for good the end of next year. So October of 2015 is our projected leave date to go out there and stay out there. We're going to go out there. We're not going to go out there with, because I don't believe we're going to be able to get enough support by then. I'm praying that we do. But if we don't get enough support, what we're going to do is go out there. We're going to be out there for 2 years. I've already talked to Brother Serino about it. We're going to go out there for 2 years and then come back on about a six-month furlough just to be able to get the rest of the support and then to be able to go out there. The Lord's really, we had a missions conference this last year, and the Lord really dealt with me about not going out with as much as I believe that we needed financially. Wow. So I talked with my pastor, I talked with Brother Serino out there as well. I said, listen, brother, I don't want to be a hindrance to you. Would it be possible for us and feasible for us to come out here with just this amount of money per month? And he said, it's feasible, you can do it. So that's what we're going to do. So if you'll pray for us, we've got Our missions cards right here, prayer cards right over here. If you'll just come up and take one today before you leave and pray for us, because we really need prayer. That's the biggest thing that we need most of all. On the back here, it's just got some pictures of these some of the teenagers that were there. We really hit it off with these teenagers. You know, I was a youth leader for a year at our church, and there's just something about teenagers that you just get attached to them. They become your kids, and it was just really neat. One of the kids that you saw, let me turn this off here. One of the kids that you saw, he was in a white shirt, one of the last pictures that was up there that I was standing next to him in. His name's Willie Omnick. And one of the nights that I preached there to the youth, he came up to me afterwards and he says, Mr. Sutton, would it be okay if I got saved today?
Amen.
And man, I tell you what, I was about to jump out of the ceiling there. And I said, so I tried to be calm and I said, are you serious? Of course you can, you know. So listen, I just want you guys to know that I'm very careful with leading somebody to the Lord. I'm not about this easy believism stuff. I'm not about 1, 2, 3, repeat after me. Because that's, I believe that's very dangerous. Because if somebody thinks that they're saved just by saying a prayer, that's going to do more harm than anything. So I took them just back to a room privately, and I just went through the scriptures again with them for probably about 8 minutes, somewhere around there. And I just made sure he understood he was a sinner on his way to hell. I understood that he believed right then and there if he were to die, he'd go to hell because of his sins. And I wanted to make sure that he understood that he couldn't get there by anything he did, only by trusting in Jesus Christ alone. And man, he accepted Christ that day. And actually, I'm on the back of this picture here, you'll see him in a white shirt right over here, holding up his Bible that we got him that next night. And just happy to be saved, happy to have a Bible in his hand. And the Lord just said, hey, listen, you might not be able to preach to thousands and thousands of people like you can in Syracuse, but you can save souls out there. And Bible says, for what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Lord just said to me, hey, listen, you can win the whole entire world, but winning souls is worth more than the whole entire world.
Amen.
And that kid right there, Willie Omnick, he's going to be in heaven. And what a blessing that is. And one of these other kids on there, his name's Corey, he just got saved. We just got word from Brother Serena out there. You know, sometimes you can't tell, of course, with kids. Sometimes they play church and they just keep hearing the preaching. You think they're saved, but you keep preaching, of course, anyway, and bringing new people. And the awesome thing is he just got saved. There is a lot of tragic things, of course, that happen out there, too. Most of the time it's dark out there, so it's very depressing. When we were out there in December, we had about an hour and a half of sunlight. So when we were out there, that's hard to get used to. Let me just say that right now. I'm not a morning person. I need coffee. All right. If I don't have coffee, most people at work know not to talk to me too much. I'll be nice. I'll be, you know, pleasant. But, man, you won't get a whole lot from me. So, but the sun would come up, and you saw it in those pictures, just a little bit over the horizon. It would just crest over just a little bit, and then it would go back down about an hour later. So you'd have about an hour and a half of sunlight from 11:30 to about 12:30. You'd have sunlight, and then it would be dark the rest of the time. And so you've got a couple months like that where you pretty much have no light at all. But then you've got about a month, month and a half of just pure daylight. And so there's a lot of suicide out there. Like me, I mean, like I said, before I got saved, I was just, you know, I was miserable, I was unhappy. But increase that twofold or even more because it's just dark all the time. Right. And they just had a suicide I believe about a month ago out there too. And that really just goes right through the whole entire village. So I'm praying that that suicide, that the Lord will be able to use it now to get people thinking about their eternal state and where they're going to go. But if you'll pray for us, we want to get out there. I mean, we love New York State. As I said on there, I thought the Lord wanted me here. My heart was here for a long time in New York State. It still is. But now the Lord's really directing me. Every time I see that video, it just makes me want to go out there even more now. Amen. So if you'll pray for us, like I said, Lord willing, we'll be out there by the end of next year. So is there any questions or anything like that I can answer? I don't know what time you want me to go till, Pastor.
Quarter of is all right.
Okay, we're about there now. Any questions at all?
Are the economies pretty much based on the whaling? Is that?
Yeah, the whaling and the fishing, like in the summertime. I love salmon, so that's one thing that I'm kind of looking forward to. Like I said, you can get with a group of people, three or four people, they'll throw the nets out there. They'll wait a little while, pull back in, and you can get a bunch of salmon and just freeze it. And my wife doesn't like seafood, but man, it's more for me then. You know? So that whale, just to let you know too, that muktuk, that is disgusting stuff. I love sushi, and what they did was they just fed it to us raw. What they do is they cut the whale up. They use every part of the whale. As you can see, this is baleen here. This is the inside of a whale's mouth. This is what it used to kind of separate the food that they get and everything like that. So they're able to like use every part of the whale, but this, what they had was just the skin and blubber. And let me just say, it's really gross. Because they just, it's rubbery and it just does not taste good. And I said, guys, I didn't put the pictures up there because my wife wouldn't let me. But you saw the picture of her looking at it. Yeah. I've got about 3 or 4 pictures real quick of her eating it and the look on her face. She wouldn't let me show that to anybody else. But one of these times I'm going to sneak that in there without her knowing. Because she didn't try and fake her way through it. She didn't like it at all. And I was like, oh, this isn't too bad. You know, I'm just trying to play it off. You know, I'm like, well, if these guys are going to like us, I got to pretend like it's good. You know, so I'm like, oh, it's not too bad. And I'm thinking, man, this is terrible. And so I'm like, do you guys just eat it like this, just alone like this? And I'm looking at everybody else. They're putting it on all their food, just like as a condiment almost. And they're putting like a whole bunch of ketchup, like just smothering it in ketchup, A1 sauce, hot sauce, everything they can get. They said, no, brother, we never eat it like that. So even as much as they've had it and they've grown up with it, you know, they still have to put stuff on it. So, but yeah, the economy, they've got the school out there too. So the school's right in that. You can actually Google Earth, Point Hope, Alaska, and you can go right in, you can see a satellite picture right over top, and you'll see right in the middle, there's this huge building, and it's the school. And the big thing out there is basketball. So what I want to be able to do is I want to be able to, Lord willing, get a basketball ministry in there. Mm-hmm. Be able to get the kids together, play some basketball at halftime, preach to them for about 15 minutes.
Wow.
And so that's the goal, is to be able to get a hold of these kids. Because we've got kids in that church that are going out and witnessing to the kids in the school system.
Wow.
But if they can see actually, you know, one of the missionaries in there. And then also in the summertime, my wife and I can go in there and we can substitute teach. So pray that that'll also be able to come to pass as well, that'll still be open. Because if we can get in there and just get the kids to know us and invite them out to church, then it won't be as, you know, hard for them to go.
Wow.
But that Episcopal church that you saw there is terrible. And I'm saying that because, number one, they don't preach the gospel, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, she's stealing a lot of the kids from Brother Serino up there. You know, in Sunday school there, they preach about the Lord Jesus Christ. In her Sunday school, she says, come on, kids, let's go to the gym and let's play at the gym. So for their Sunday school, the little kids are not getting any Bible at all, anything about Jesus Christ. So like I said, Lord willing, he needs a lot of help out there. And I'm hoping that we'll be able to reach the rest of the four villages as well. So anything else? Yes.
How many people are
in that area? In that village, is about 850. And most of them all are Inupiaq Eskimos. And but there's other villages, like there's about, like I said, 4 other villages that haven't been reached. Those range for anywhere from 400 to 900 people per village. Yep. So Bear was the biggest one. That's got almost 5,000 people in it. And this is the thing, that if you know anything about the offshore drilling and stuff like that, Bear's got that. That's why it's so big right now. They're talking about maybe Point Hope going that way. And if it goes that way, there's going to be a boom of people coming in. And so whether that's going to be a good thing or not, of course there'll be troubles with it, but maybe it'll be another opportunity to be able to see a lot more souls too. So they're about 50-50. I looked online. They did a poll, I think in 2011, 2012. 50 people were for it, 50 villages were against it. So they're not able to pass it. Because they're worried about if the oil spill, then their livelihood, you know, of whaling and all that kind of stuff is in jeopardy. So any other questions?
Can you hunt for like caribou? And
yeah, they've got musk ox is what it's called.
Musk ox.
Yeah, so it's like an oxen with, just looks really hairy. And I never saw one up close, but I saw pictures of it. So you can go out there and hunt, which I'm looking forward to doing. But you can't hunt polar bear. The villagers can, but I can't. The only time I could hunt, kill a polar bear is if it's in self-defense. And hopefully I won't have to do that. But when we were out there, it was funny. When we were out there in the old village, like I said, Brother Serino, we got out there about halfway, and the vehicle is so far away, the truck's so far away. And he said, now, brother, I've got about 7 shots in this gun right here. He said, probably won't take a bear down. So if you see one, you better run to the truck. I said, oh, great, thanks. Welcome to the yard, right?
Wow.
So, our plan is to go out there. He has a four-wheeler. He's got a four-wheel drive truck, and he also has a, I think it's a 15-passenger four-wheel drive van. And so I told him, amazing what he does. On a Sunday, he goes out and gets the kids, comes back. He goes out probably about 10 or 12 times to go pick different people up, because because the you know they have to ship in all the materials to build. So they've got a small building there for all of the services. So they go out and they bring in different kids over all day long on Sunday and of course Wednesday, and then you've got Ladies Bible Study Thursday, RU Friday. So he's going out, and I said, brother, I want if it's okay with you, I want to take that ministry off of your shoulders, is to take that bus ministry for him. So he'll be able to allow us to have that four-wheel drive passenger van if we ever need it. We'll have that at our place. And the amazing thing is that right behind the church, he was able to buy a house. I believe it was about 4 or 5 years ago from a lady, which never happens because usually you buy, you know, if somebody buys a house, it is the natives that live there. And he was able to buy the house. So he's got his house right next to the church. And then right behind the church, right through our window, you can see the church. And that's the Lord. And he said, of course, you can stay right in that place. So we'll have to rent that out from him and stuff like that because they're still paying that off. But praise the Lord, we're right next to the church, which is a blessing. Amen. And so we're going to go out there with a four-wheeler. You have to take a barge from Seattle and take that barge all the way to Point Hope and get your four-wheeler and your things like that off from there. So, yes, sir?
What's the temperature range?
Temperature, when we were there, was about negative 40, negative 45. And some of those pictures, we've got other pictures where like this, because it's so cold, because it's just it eats right through you. I mean, you know, I grew up in New York State my whole life, so I'm used to a little bit of the cold here. But when you go out there, there's no trees, there's no bushes, there's no anything that's going to stop the wind. So the wind chill is the biggest thing. It can get down to negative 80. And when we were in our house and we felt the house shaking because the wind just nonstop, it just batters the houses. When it starts shaking the house, Brother Serino said that's when you know it's almost 50 mile an hour winds. And so that's one of those things too. You're just dealing with the wind. You're dealing with the snow drifts. He said he gets 5, 6, 7, 8 feet high snow drifts that just bury his van and his truck and the house. So you're just constantly going out there and you're just working on maintenance. And so that's another thing too that he has to deal with out there.
Well, how about starting the vehicles and weather like that?
Yeah, he's got a diesel truck. And he's got that hooked up to his house to where it's, you know, heated throughout, so he's able to start it. We're going to build, he said that he'll help me build a enclosure for the van. And that way we'll be able to put it in, have it a little bit, you know, a little bit out of the elements and things like that. So, yeah. But yeah, it usually takes a while to warm up the vehicles. You usually warm it up for about 15 minutes, somewhere around there, 20 minutes.
So where's the gas and... Yeah.
They've got
is there a mobile station there?
Yeah, they've got a little, I didn't have a picture of it, but they've got one little gas station with two, you know, two things there. They get fuel oil and fuel once a year. So the barge comes in. So that's how they heat their houses, is fuel oil. And so they come in, but, you know, everything's expensive there. Everything is about four times as expensive as it is here. Yeah. So we went into, they have just a little general store. That's all they have. They have a gas station, a general store, which has about six aisles. And they have a post office. And when you go into the store there, a can of, you know, vegetables or whatever, I don't know how much it is here now, but out there it's about $4, a little bit more. So everything there is about three or four times the amount of money that is here. Yeah. So, yes, sir.
Yeah, do people who live around that village just kind of stay around the village? Maybe
yeah.
They've got, like, you know, within walking distance, they don't go to other places?
Yeah, they can't because they would have to fly out. What they do, the sad thing is that they get checks from the Eskimo Corporation, from the North Slope Borough, it's called. And so they get about a $4,000 or $5,000 check per person that's in the household. And so they get that about once or twice a year, depending on the family. And so what happens is that a lot of times you would think that they would take that and save that money. But they take that and then they go out to a bigger city, like Anchorage or Fairbanks or Juneau, wherever. And they go out there and they party for about a week or 2 weeks. The sad thing is that they take their kids with them. So they're going out there binge drinking, you know, drugs, and they go out there for a week or 2 weeks with this money and just waste it all. And my wife was there with Kathleen, if you saw that picture with them together, they really hit it off. And on a Thursday night at a ladies' Bible study, Kathleen broke down. It's a teenager that's there. Broke down in tears because they had just gotten their checks just a week ago when we got there. And she did not want to, she was crying and she said, I don't want to go with my parents again and have to deal with all of that. You know. So our goal also, Lord willing, if it's able to, is that the house that's behind the church there has three bedrooms. If it's possible, we'll be able to talk to the parents and say, listen, would you be okay with us while you go and do that? If we can't stop you, would it be okay if we have your kids come and stay with us? And so if that's a possibility, that's what we want to work on as well. And just because you can save those kids out of that situation, but also you can minister to them. If they're not saved, you can hopefully witness to them and see them get saved. So, yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Pastor.
And all God's people said.
Amen.
All right, good. You get up and stretch a little bit and all, and we'll get